thanks for coming in. First of all, I would like to just like put in a point that this is one of my first talks in front of such large crowd. So please, I'm sorry for
okay.
Once more, okay, good. So back to the topic, the do's and don'ts of a task queue. First question, who knows what a task queue is? Okay, good, perfect. I will first begin with who am I, and my name is Peter, as I said before, and I am a Python developer at kiwi.com, specifically in a finance tribe. We take care of all the finance-related stuff during your whole booking process and afterwards. And this comes with quite a lot of stuff around it. So back to the talk. Here's the outline of the talk, and we will first talk about the task queues in general, just to get up to speed with everyone. Then I will tell you a short story, fuck up story, with a happy ending. Then we will talk about examples versus reality and how it comes all together. And then we will skip back to the story and the final setup of the application that I'll be talking about in the story. Then we will continue with how we do it in Kiwi, and there will be a small surprise in there. And one of the last parts will be the lessons learned or the simple checklist on what to check during the development of things working with task queues, and specifically with Celery. And afterwards, because I asked just for a 30-minute window and got 45 minutes, there will be quite a larger Q&A section, so you can ask me anything related to the talk, okay, just to be sure. So, task queues. Let's go ahead. I was trying to define task queues in one simple sentence. I failed miserably, so it's just a single sentence and not an easy one. So a task queue usually executes in parallel, and the tasks in the task queue are discrete and they are non-blocking. Task queues, usually when it comes to Python and other high-level languages, we imagine Celery or Redis queues or RabbitMQ and else. Don't. It's not just Celery. Task queues are actually used in much lower levels than usually. And we can find them, for example, in CPUs when we are scheduling all the instructions and everything. It's part of the CS, computer science. We can learn about round robin, FIFO, LIFO, and other queues. But let's get back to the higher level. And we have four main parts for a task queue. First one is a queue, basically the line where everyone steps in when wanting something. I found a picture, quite nice, depicting the story. We have the queue for bananas. So that's the queue, the people that are waiting for it. We have the task, that's the unit of work that we want to do, and here, the task is to buy a banana or two or whatever. Then we have the producer that produces the task, the unit of work. And that is the consumer or the one who wants to buy the banana. And the consumer that is the selling the bananas. I hope you understand a bit. It's maybe a bit complicated. So, This is what a task queue is. Now, for what a task queue is. Usually, we want to decouple long-running tasks from a synchronous HTTP call. You hit a REST API, and you need to wait for a couple of seconds, tens of seconds, even minutes, when it's badly designed or waiting for other stuff to happen. And this is what a task queue is mainly for in higher languages. So to decouple these long-running tasks. And if you sprinkle in, for example, callbacks, you can get a really, really decoupled tasks that can afterwards be handled upon the result they ended up with. The second use case is perform something periodically and not to rely on cron, because sometimes we can't use cron or we don't have reliable source of periodicity. So you will initiate a periodic worker with salary, for example, and you can do something regularly, like refresh database indexes. That's a wrong example, sorry. Like obtain new information from an API regularly, or clean up something every day, every week, every now and then. Then, next use case, it's a smaller use case, is to break down software to more isolated pieces, but microservice is too big for such task. So you can break it down to just a task in a salary or its own queue or something like this. Because with microservices, there comes a lot of scaffolding around the microservice. If it's not, for example, a Lambda function. If it's a normal REST API and everything, you will have a lot of scaffolding around. You will have problems with authentication, authorization, tests, and everything. Another pro for task queues is to minimize wait time, latency, or response time. That basically means that if you have the long running HTTP call that you decide to queue or to use queues on, you can have an immediate response on the HTTP endpoint. But then afterwards, you can have a callback that will mark the task as finished, and it will hit your first party API after the third party API is done with the job. And with this increased response time and minimized wait time, you will naturally increase throughput of the system. This can be also achieved by scaling the tasks and workers appropriately. And with task queues, you can scale horizontally, like adding more queues and more containers and everything, to also vertically, like adding more workers and resources. So this is all pros. We will talk about the cons later on when we are considering why to use and why not to use task queues, but generally I would say that we should use them. And now to the story time that I want to share with you. In our finance tribe, we have a microservice called Fantozzi. Does anybody know this name, actually? Okay, one, two, okay, a couple, so good. Still, I will explain it. Fantozzi is an accountant, Italian accountant, and there were a couple of movies about him in like 70s, 80s, something like this, and he's really, really unlucky, and unfortunate events happen to him all the time. It's really nice comedy and everything, so you should watch it. Just a recommendation. And this microservice handles accounting in general. Okay. So, can you see the pointer? Actually, I'm just using something new in Google Docs. So good. So we have Fantozzi as a whole microservice. We have requests coming in, and they want to do something with accounting, like generate an invoice, submit something to another system for accounting, like for the accountants, real accountants, and like communicate something in between. It's the middleman in all the accounting in Kiwi. And we had it running for a couple of years now, and we wanted to do a revamp, like Fantozzi 2.0, to make it better, faster, stronger, reliable. So, back to the flow. We have a request. The request will be validated, and we now started deciding on what framework, technologies, and everything we will use. And we knew we wanted to use task queues, and our like go-to tool in Kiwi was at that time Celery, and it still is. But I will talk about it later. And we decided to be different and think outside the box, to use Redis queues, or RQ in short, Python RQ. Because as it's advertised, it's easier, more maintainable, and the hop-on curve is much steeper and quicker. So we tried to use it, and let's see how it goes without even properly reading the documentation and everything. And during these decisions and the talks, there were a couple of red flags or sentences that were said during this. One of them is, new is always better. Be careful always about this, because it can be true, but it doesn't have to be. Because when you have something tested and rigorously proven to be reliable and used with many people inside the company with quite a lot of inside knowledge, you don't usually want to introduce something brand new to the flow, to the new developers. And when you have a team that is more dynamic, you will have to have always an onboarding session with the new technology. But if you use an industry standard, most of the developers will know it. Easy peasy. Second red flag is think outside the box. You know, not usually the true in case of integration and third party API communication and everything. So be careful about this one, because not usually, usually you don't want to do everything outside the box. This is another good one. I know everything I need. Come on, I have read the documentation of the Python RQ or the Celery. In reality, you read just the introduction and the installation, and that's it. But you still think you know everything, because, come on, it cannot be that difficult, right? And of course, I can do it better, right? I can make it on my own, and it will be always better than this big framework that is written by a couple of hundreds of people, tested and developed for a couple of years now. And it's done by real professionals, you know? So be careful about this sentence. Really, this one is the reddest of the flags. So back to the schema. We have the RQ manager. And to be nice and beautiful, we will have tons of queues to have correct priorities set and all the workers on top of it and correctly naming it and having it debugged properly and everything in future. So it's really beautiful. The design is beautiful. You love it and you dream about it all the time. And we have the webhook lib or the callback library that will call back to the service that initiated the request. Of course, we will have the data storage in a database, and we will have the cloud services that I don't want to mention because, you know, I am not a marketing guy, and we have S3 storage as well, so it can be public. For example, for obtaining the invoices of the customers. We developed this, me and my colleague, we have been developing this for a couple of weeks. We had it working and everything, it was good. It was rather a larger merge request. And then I decided like, okay, you have finished it. And I will try to deploy it on my local machine to see how it works and how it behaves. I spent deploying on my local machine about 4 or 5 hours without even being successful. And in the end, I wasn't able to our beautiful custom-made Redis RQ on the steroids ecosystem to run properly on my local machine. So a bit of thinking time went by, a day or two. And we went into other projects that were using Celery to get a bit of inspiration how they did it before and how it behaved. And we just were like, okay, so they use Celery for some reason. Let's see if we can come up with a reason for us as well. The reason was very simple, because the implementation of Celery took us about 2 days. We just copy-pasted most of the stuff. We adjusted it to our needs, and we were good to go in less than 16 hours of development time, without even dropping a drop of sweat. So this is how we discarded Redis RQ for our needs. because we weren't properly thinking of the all use cases that we're gonna need. And I'm gonna show you why it happened. The simple reason was examples that were in the docs and the reality that we needed. Because in the documentation, you can usually see these beautiful five liners, a couple of liners to instantiate everything and to have everything set up and go. And everything is green, everything is superb. And you're happy with your task queues and you can do magic stuff with it, right? This is how it's advertised in docs, usually. The reality was a bit different because in Redis RQs, there is not much of a feature to retry a job properly. So we had to write our own. Don't try to understand the code. It's just an excerpt to scare you off, you know. It was just a mess. It's just a mess of code that tries to do a proper repetition. That is in salary included, like battery included, really. Included, really. So this piece of code that you can see in salary is done very, very, very similarly to this. Because you have just a couple of parameters and you're good to go. But still, you can see that the simple decorator app task that was in the example, oh, it doesn't have any parameters, right? Here, we have five of them and we're not even finished. In the documentation, you can even have like 10 or 15 of those parameters. And you can use all of them in one single use case. And in the end, when we were implementing the salary, the merge request that was finished was across 18 files. Just to mention, the Fantozzi is around 1,500 lines big now. And you can see that it was the change was spread across 18 files in more than 200 lines of code. So it was super granular. There were little changes over a lot of files. And that, of course, is hard to review, approve, and test. So be careful about that. And we managed. We used Celery. We are happy with it, and it works. That's the most important part. Now I would like to show you the final setup that we are working with in Kiwi with Fantozzi. And with which one we are happy. As the base, we are using Python and PostgreSQL for the basic stuff, with on top of Flask and Connexion, together with, of course, Celery and Redis as a broker. We are using multiple deploy targets in the continuous integration pipeline. And for monitoring, we are using Logs.io and Datadog. And if something goes bad, we use Sentry for catching all the errors. And if something goes really bad, we have PagerDuty and on calls with proper scheduling of all the guys in our finance tribe. So how we do it in Kiwi in general? This is the surprise. Because it's exactly like Fantozzi is done. So we have, again, Python, Flask, Connexion, and so on, and so on, and so on. So in more detail, I want to tell you. In Python, all projects are usually written in Python 2, occasionally in Python 3 earlier versions than 3.5. So we are always trying to migrate these projects to 3.6 or newer. And if you are starting new projects or revamping older projects, they're always doing it in Python 3.6 plus. Fantozzi specifically is written in 3.7 currently. We are always, when designing new application or redesigning applications, we are always trying to utilize the microservice architecture in contrast to monolith. And most importantly, we use REST HTTP APIs. For this. Flask is our go-to framework / micro framework, to be correct. We have quite a lot of boilerplates for Flask, And with that, we can do quick scaffolding. For this, I wanted to, there's a code excerpt on the right, where you can see our whole application of Fantozzi to be scaffolded in like a couple of lines of code. You can see there the Flask configuration, or the configuration of the whole app, is done via objects and via YAML schemas, or to be precise, with OpenAPI 3 specification and together with Connexion. That's an extension to Flask, and it can generate the REST HTTPI via the OpenAPI 3 specification and add beautiful Swagger web page or endpoint to your service for other developers to see how to use your API. It's really useful because when some guy asks you on Slack, how can we use Fantozzi to get all the invoices? It's super simple. I open the Swagger specification online. I find the correct endpoint. I copy the URL for it, and I just paste it in the Slack channel without even another letter. And it's usually enough for the guys to understand, okay, he has this endpoint, he needs this authorization. So eventually, in day or two, I will get a new direct message. Hey, can I get a token for Fantozzi? Well, or can I use the old token that we are using in other service? And I'm usually like, no, you will get a new token because the old one will be otherwise turned off, and the whole Kiwi will fall down if you use it. So I don't want to compromise on this at all because security. But that's for consideration in the next part. We are using token-based authentication currently without authorization because all the services need the same level of access. So authorization is currently not on topic for us, but Connexion is capable of authorization on per endpoint. And that's why we also want to use separate tokens for separate services. This is just a future-proofing of the app. Next, we have the Celery. And in a couple of minutes, I will talk about the best practices for Celery, about what we have learned during development of Fantozzi and how we failed miserably during the development. And for Celery broker, we are using Redis deployed on AWS. And you might ask why we use Redis and not, for example, RabbitMQ or any other AMQP service for this. And it's very simple. Because Redis is simple, it's reliable on AWS, and it's super easy to deploy. Because Redis is always duplicated on AWS, so if an instance fails, there's always a failover mechanism, and you won't even notice that the container failed. So it's super reliable for us in this, and we won't lose the tasks. And of course, with RabbitMQ and everything, there are quite a lot of more stuff included in it, which we don't really need right now. Next up is the multiple deploy targets. We are using the HTTP API, REST API for this. And we have workers. We have these two deploy targets, for example. And we have an internal tool made by our beautiful platform guys to deploy it on Rancher by just one click in the CI. And you can see the GitLab CI's command in the code excerpt. And this is basically all that is needed to deploy new version of Fantozzi onto production. And it's done usually in like 30 seconds, maybe a minute, if the containers are harder to spin up. For logging and measuring the performance of the application, we are using Logs.io and Datadog. Logs.io for logs and Datadog for performance-related metrics and for usage-related metrics, together with endpoint usage and everything related to it. Because Datadog can hook onto the internals of Flask to really monitor everything per endpoint, and you can have beautiful beautiful dashboards if you take time to make them. But you need to do it properly. I can show you afterwards if you're interested. Then we use Sentry. That's for when an exception occurs, something goes wrong. So we can see what happened, with what parameters, so we can replicate what happened, and if we can replicate it. And if something goes really badly, we have pager duty and on calls. And there's already 6 people in the schedule, and we are doing the 24-hour on-call policy, basically meaning that we switch on-call duties every day. And you have it over the night, and of course there are some rules to it, how we do it. Of course, again, we can return back to it if we have time. So, one of the last sections, lessons learned. This is the most important one. I hope you're still alive and listening to me. First one, always use Redis or AMQP, aka RabbitMQ, for example, brokers. Never use a database. Why, you are asking? Because with Celery, you can kill database very easily. You spin up more workers in the or containers to poll for new tasks, but Celery doesn't use any push mechanism from a database. It's always polling the database for new changes. And when you are polling from a couple of hundreds of workers on a single database instance, suddenly your selects, inserts, and updates are getting slower. You know? And eventually, it will time out and kill the database. So always use an in-memory database with push ability. Second, pass simple objects to the tasks. Never pass, for example, ORM objects to the task, for example, from SQL Alchemy. Why, again? Because the objects can go stale. They can get old, they don't have to be updated. You will lose the references. It's bad. Just pass the ID and do the select again. It's cheaper, actually. 3, do not wait for tasks inside tasks. It's an asynchronous mechanism, so do it asynchronously. Yes, you can chain the tasks together, but never await the tasks inside tasks, because then you can hit the recursion limits, for example, or the retry limits, and you will have a stack of stuck infinite tasks. So that's a bad practice, really. Next one is the use retry limit to get rid of stuck tasks. Always aim for like 5 repetitions or 10 repetitions, depending on what the use case of the task is. But if it's an HTTP call, yes, you can use the sessions repeater as well. So you have to multiply the numbers. So for example, we generally use 5 retries per task. And if it just doesn't do what we need, we will put it to Sentry and to our logging and see why it got stuck later on. With this, with retrying, use auto retry 4. This is a mechanism from Celery that catches specific exceptions only and retries them, retries the task based on the exception. Best use case, connection errors and generally networking errors during the task. Use retry backoff and retry jitter. This is when you have a couple of hundreds of tasks that are being executed. They are of the same nature and they fail because the third party server is not complying with your request. Basically, it can be shut down, there can be a network error, or you just hit the API rate limiting. With the retry backoff and retry jitter, it will exponentially increase the wait time between the tries with the retry backoff. And the retry jitter will add a bit of bit of some random, a couple of secs, milliseconds to the execution. So the tasks are not retried at the same time exactly, but randomly spread out between 1 second, for example. It depends on how the defaults are used or what your parameters are in the retry jitter. It's best to use the documentation and consider the best alternative for you. Set hard and soft time limits for the task, because you cannot wait infinitely for some third-party API call or for some query to a database or something. So always use the soft time limit to gracefully kill the task and retry it. Or if there is no help, just kill it and try it again. And have the system that initiated the task to submit it again. Of course, for this you need callbacks and the status mechanism to be reported back to the service. But that's another thing to consider. Use bind for an extra oomph in the tasks. Best for logging and handling the exceptions when something goes really bad for you, what you don't expect. With bind, you can manage the retry mechanism by yourself. And you can log everything into your logging system, and you can replicate in case of failure, or you can store actually the task for later to be retried. This can be stored in a database if you have a good reason to store it permanently. One of the last, use separate queues for demanding tasks. For example, you have a task that usually takes 10 milliseconds. It's just marking something in a third-party system to be, for example, active or to disable it or delete it. It takes a couple of milliseconds to do it. And then you have a task that inserts new records to a large system, and it can take up to a minute to actually create the records. And then you have all these tasks, like let's say you have 1,000 tasks, 990 of them are changing the status, and 10 of them is inserting a new record. You can guess what happens when the workers are picking up the tasks. The long-running tasks will starve. They will be there infinitely. They will be starved out. So for these demanding tasks, use a separated worker and separated queue with a higher priority. That's the best way. And the last one, a bit of theoretical, and for that I have a small help. Prefer idempotency and atomicity in your tasks. And idempotency is something can you read it? Okay, it's a bit of. So I will try to paraphrase it. Basically, when you have an idempotent task, you will call the task infinite times, and it will always produce the same result without server side effects. The response can be different, but the message inside, what it bears, will be the same. For example, I created a resource, or I deleted a resource. But there is no side effect apart from creating the resource or deleting the resource. Nothing else. Atomic operation is basically an operation or function, in our case, that happens instantaneously, like right away. You don't wait for anything. And it usually has a definite result, usually Boolean. It was successful or unsuccessful. That's an atomic operation. I'm sorry for all mathematicians here. It's a very rough definition for it. But I would say that for programmers, it's enough. So this was these were the lessons learned. I will post this presentation into the Slack, so you don't have to take pictures of it or anything. And I will post a bit more resources there as well to check for you because there's a beautiful checklist for celery. Next up is to the things that we want to consider during development with celery. Celery has one, let's say, bigger niggle for development in our case, and that is when you are generally developing with celery, you are sharing code base between the producer and consumer, meaning that the same code is deployed on the workers and on the HTTP API. This doesn't have to be true. You can do it a bit differently, but still they need to be aware of each other, what each other is called, what they require, and what they do. And sometimes this coupling is troublesome. But these are corner cases usually. You just need to bear it in mind. Celery is huge. Read its docs. It's a long read, but very, very, let's say, insightful one. And with the docs, you can use Celery to its full potential. You won't remember everything, all the parameters that Celery offers. But once you read the documentation, you will know where to find it and that it's there somewhere, maybe. So you can use it to its full potential. Just do it, it's best. And be aware of the scalability of third-party APIs that you are using in the workers because, yes, your application can be beautifully scalable, but the third-party API can have a rough rate limiting on you, so better be aware of it. You know. Thanks for the attention. I see a couple of questions, and really thanks for listening to me. I hope you liked it.
Thank you very much. Okay, thanks for this talk. Let's come to the questions. I will answer the third one.
Let's start with the first one. How do you ensure that messages are not lost in case of a problem with the queue or network?
Yeah, with Redis.
Yeah, exactly. With Redis, and we don't take care of this at all. This is the AWS job. In our case, because they should be reliable. The Redis there should be reliable.
Yes, but okay. What if it's not?
It's an evasive answer, let's say, because the reliability is usually not our problem as the finance tribe developers. It's our platform and DevOps department work.
So you shift the responsibility on the
people. The responsibility is shifted a bit to other teams. So we really didn't take into account the true proper reliability of Redis into account because we believe that the DevOps guys and the platform guys did their job well.
Okay, yeah. Thanks. Still, I will try the third one. So, can you make a task atomic? Normally, you do atomicity on the database, yeah? So you can isolate in a transaction the whole task that happens. In case the task fails, you will not execute any of the SQL queries. You will not commit those. But
that's the ACID principle.
Yeah,
right?
But how about third-party services? Yeah, so if you are sending some, you know?
Yeah, that's another question. You usually can't. There's a problem. But you can always aim for atomicity in your application or your tasks. And in general, you always be happier when something like this happens.
Okay.
So that's why I said that prefer, not like enforce. Try to design it with idempotency and atomicity in mind, but don't enforce it hard, because sometimes this trying to be atomic and idempotent can be a disadvantage.
Yeah, overkill or it's not worth the effort.
So just don't overdo anything. Be reliable. Be your own mind. You know?
And then pass the code review, so you are also the mind of the person.
Yeah, and write tests. That's the most important part.
So how do you scale with deal with scaling the workers that are meant for the same queue? Normally, Celery has this auto scaling, but what if you scale over one machine? Is it possible somehow?
we really haven't like hit this limit currently, because we know when the machine is overloaded.
Then?
So we will scale down the workers a bit, but we will deploy more containers for the queue. Yeah. So you will do the horizontal scaling, not just vertical.
Okay, so...
So that's the beauty of Celery, because you can do both versions of scaling.
And also, so what is deploying those containers? It can be
automated, I believe. Uh-huh. But usually we do it manually because we want to have a control over it, and it's not happening that often.
Yeah, sure.
We are just watching the queues, how long are they? And if they are over threshold, we will just increase the workers in the first place. Because we have them auto-scaled, for example, from 3 to 10. Mm-hmm. And if it's, we can scale them to, let's say, 15, for example. And if it's that's not enough, we'll add another container with 10 more workers. Yeah. And if that's not enough, again, then the bottleneck is somewhere else.
Yeah, sure. Then something
is wrong
in the system.
Basically, when you have a long queue, it means that the third-party API is slow or failing, usually.
You can get with an infinite queue waiting for something else that's happening.
Yeah, exactly, and that's why you have the hard and soft time limits in Celery.
So, but in general, in Celery, you can do auto-scaling. It's built in the Celery framework itself.
Yeah, but it's just the workers scaling.
Yeah, for the workers.
Yeah, it's really nice. It's super easy when you are just running the workers. There's a parameter, I believe, it's minus capital A. And then you just put the maximum and the minimum, and you're good to go. It's taken care of by Celery. Perfect.
Okay. So is atomicity? I think you answered this one. Is atomicity and independency required to be always implemented from the ground up, or there are some useful helper tools? These database transactions. Yeah.
Yeah, again.
Obviously, it is on the layer of you use it in Celery, you can specify whether it will be atomic or not.
Yeah, exactly.
But
we have answered it a bit before.
So yeah, before, yeah.
I hope that's enough for Mr. Anonymous.
Yeah, and I think this is one of the last ones. So I'm not sure whether this can happen.
This is a bit different because the unstable network, that's for picking up a job from Redis. That's from the broker. Uh-huh. You pick up the job, or basically the job is pushed to worker, uh-huh. And it's the best effort delivery, as far as I know.
So you can, you will... the worker will receive the task and it will execute it. Yeah. But can it happen that you can accidentally execute it twice?
Probably yes, but I am not that well read on the internals of Celery. Uh-huh. But I believe they have thought of this and it's somehow handled. And another thing is, if you have unstable network with your broker and Celery, then there is something broken in your development operations.
Possibly, or you have...
Because if you have a tightly coupled containers or services that need to work together, you need to have them reliable. And the best way is to have it in the same data center or your in-house server or whatever, just local network. That's the best way. Mm. And with Amazon, I believe that they handled it. Yeah, it's always questionable, but...
Sometimes you have all these... parallel carriers of the broadband infrastructure, having the cables in the same slot, and then are these highway workers that just cut all three cables in once. Yeah. That's your redundancy in the delivery.
Yeah, well, it's something that you can't be prepared for unless you manage your own hardware.
Yeah, and your own infrastructure, and
everything.
So. Sure. Thank you very much.
Thank you.